Hi, welcome back to The Basement. I'm Steve Lewis. Today I wanted to talk about Bruce Johnston's solo album, Goin' Public, which was released in May of 1977 and produced by Gary Usher. It's certainly a unique album, being Bruce's second solo album and, to date, his most recent solo album. His other only proper solo album, of course, had been 1963's Surfin' Round the World. So Goin' Public was quite a different proposition in 1977. The first thing a record buyer in 1977 would have noticed about this album, of course, is the cover. It features a photo that was well known to all Beach Boy fans, the same photo that was used on the inner sleeve of the Sunflower album 7 years earlier. I'm an accountant, so to me, going public means taking a privately held company and turning it into a publicly traded entity. Of course, going public can also mean taking a private matter and talking about it in public, sort of spilling the beans on some celebrity gossip or dishing dirt. I don't know how either one of those meanings of this title is supposed to tie in with Bruce in wedding attire 7 years earlier. It seems like they could have done something like put him in a group surrounded by microphones, or they could have done a phony tell-all book cover, or something along those lines. They could have showed him in a corporate boardroom. So I'm not really sure how this photo is supposed to tie in with the title. I also think, because it's such an old photo, already 7 years old at the time it was used, and very well known, at least to Beach Boy fans, that it really gives the impression that this is either some kind of a dodgy reissue of old tracks, or that at the very least, they didn't think it was important enough to give it its own artwork. So it doesn't make a very good first impression. The back cover photo is actually much nicer. It's a nice color photo of Bruce on Catalina Island. Apparently, from the rope in his hand, he's about to engage in a tug of war with some unseen opponent. There are two photos on the inner sleeve, both of which are also nice, and either of those photos, I think, would have made a better front cover if they were printed in color. And as I often complain about with Beach Boy covers, there's just a lot of empty space here that really diminishes the impact of the cover. They could have taken this photo, printed it large on the front. I think it would have made a much, much better album cover. Moving on to the music, the album kicks off with the track that is probably the main reason for the album's existence. It's I Write the Songs by Bruce Johnston. The song was copyright 1974 and was first covered on the Captain and Tennille's number two hit album from the summer of 1975, Love Will Keep Us Together. There was another version released a little later on in 1975 on David Cassidy's The Higher They Climb album. This version was co-produced by Bruce, who provides backing vocals, piano, and did the vocal and string arrangements. Carl Wilson also provides a very prominent backing vocal on the track. The song was released as a single in the UK and actually reached number 11 on the UK charts. Then, of course, there was Barry Manilow's version from his October 1975 album, Trying to Get the Feeling Again. Bruce has said that the I in I Write the Songs refers to God or to the spirit of creativity within everyone. Barry Manilow was apparently a little reluctant at first to cover the song because, as he said in his 1987 autobiography, Sweet Life, the problem with the song was that if you didn't listen carefully to the lyric, you would think the singer was singing about himself. It could be misinterpreted as a monumental ego trip. I remember that was pretty much my reaction when I first heard Barry Manilow's version on the radio in the fall of 1975. I assumed this was a song written by Barry Manilow about his own songwriting capabilities. I think a lot of people probably thought that, particularly at the time, if there was one thing you knew about Barry Manilow, it was that he was a songwriter who had started out doing commercial jingles for things like McDonald's, Pepsi, and Band-Aid. When I've seen Bruce perform the song with the Beach Boys, Mike always prefaces it by telling the audience that the song was not written by Barry Manilow, it was written by Bruce Johnston. So apparently, that assumption that Barry Manilow wrote it persists to this day. Barry Manilow's version hit number one in January of 1976, and in March of 1977, Bruce took home the Grammy for Song of the Year. The success of Barry Manilow's single and Bruce's Grammy win were, I'm sure, the main reason that the album was made and released in May 1977, just 2 months after the Grammy was awarded. Bruce's own version of I Write the Songs is a little slower, more restrained, even stately compared to the Manilow version. It stays pretty simple throughout, apart from some backing vocals, until the end when the California Boys Choir comes in and gives it a sort of a vocal swell that ends the track. Next up is Deirdre, which of course we all know as a Brian Wilson co-write from the Sunflower album in 1970. This version brings up the tempo and adds a disco beat and some very mid-70s guitar licks. It also features a saxophone break and some horns in the latter part of the song. This isn't a full-on disco-fying of the song the way Bruce would do with Here Comes the Night for the Beach Boys the next year, but this is definitely meant to be danced to. Third up, we have Bruce's Thank You Baby, which first appeared as the B-side of Bruce and Terry's Come Love in January 1966, where it had an orchestra and harpsichord giving it a very mid-60s pop sound. Bruce had also co-produced and co-arranged a version of the song for Graham Bonney, which was released as a single in the UK early in 1967. This one has a more prominent drum that really helps propel this version along. It still has a real mid-60s sound in the harpsichord break, but it's a little more muscular than the other versions, and this is probably my favorite version of Thank You Baby. More recently, and probably the reason it was included on Going Public, was that Thank You Baby had been covered by The Captain and Tennille on their sophomore effort from 1976, Song of Joy. Like many of the tracks on his album, Bruce's version is stripped down, which suits the song well and makes the melody clear. It has nice Beach Boy-esque backing vocals, especially in a wordless harmony section in the middle. There's a cello that comes in at the end, which might have been nice to hear more of. Actually, the song is probably a little twee and sentimental for my taste, particularly the section that goes, "Please Don't Hurt Me." Next up is a song co-written with the Hudson Brothers named Rendezvous. The Hudson Brothers, Bill, Mark, and Brett, had a primetime summer replacement series on CBS in 1974 with the same producers and some of the same on-air talent as the Sonny and Cher show. In the fall of 1974, they were given a half-hour comedy variety show for kids on Saturday mornings, which ran for 1 year and made them for a while teen idols. From their 1975 album Baffa, a single version had gone to number 26 on the US charts in 1975, giving them their second and, as it turned out, last top 40 hit after the single You Are a Star, which went to number 21 in 1974. This is the closest thing to a rocker on Bruce's album, and I use that term loosely. It does feature electric guitar rather than piano, which not surprisingly is the main instrument on most of the album. It's looser than the Hudson Brothers version, which is more polished and seems to have been produced specifically to be the A-side that it became. Following Rendezvous, side one of Going Public closes out with the first of two cover versions on the album, Lindsay DePaul's Won't Somebody Dance With Me. Lindsay DePaul was an English singer-songwriter who had some chart success in the UK in the early 70s, including a couple of top tens, but was little known in the US. Won't Somebody Dance With Me had gone to number 14 in the UK for her in 1973. It's an extremely odd choice, and with the practically limitless universe of songs that Bruce could have covered, I really would love to know why he settled on this. The lyrics work best from a female point of view, so the verses have been rewritten to have Bruce singing about his daughter going to a dance, and then in the transition to the chorus, he sings, "And she says to me," then this extremely high-pitched female voice takes over, singing about "Won't somebody dance with me," while Bruce offers interjections like, "Have patience, sweetheart." At the end, another male voice comes in and says, "Hi, my name is Doug. Would you like to dance?" And then the female voice sings, "I found somebody to dance with me." I wish I'd just gone ahead and sang, "I found Doug to dance with me." They might as well have gone the extra mile and just done that with it. It's exceedingly corny, and I can well understand the reluctance of guys to ask this girl to dance when her father is standing there coaching her and offering running commentary on what she's thinking. It's a very, very strange choice for a cover, and really the low point of Going Public. Side two starts off much more promisingly with Disney Girls. Along with I Write the Songs, Disney Girls is Bruce's other greatest hit, and probably the finest song he ever wrote. Of course, we're all familiar with the Beach Boys version from 1971's Surf's Up album. Other notable versions of the song include Cass Elliot's version from her 1972 self-titled album. This version features both Bruce and Carl Wilson on backing vocals. From May of 1975, The Captain and Tennille included a version on their debut album, Love Will Keep Us Together. From September of 1975, Art Garfunkel covered it on his Breakaway album. This version features Bruce on piano and backing vocals. And less well known, but of potential more interest to Beach Boy fans, is from October 1975, Papa Do-Run Run's single Be True to Your School, which features Disney Girls on the B-side. Bruce not only produced both sides of the Papa Do-Run Run single, he played piano and did lead vocal on the version of Disney Girls that appears on the B-side. Bruce's piano and vocal are the only things on the track, so in all but name, this is a Bruce Johnston solo performance. For the most part, this is a really nice version, too. It's much looser than what he does on the Goin' Public album. It has almost jazz sort of influences. It speeds up and slows down with some really beautiful piano and vocal flourishes. He seems very relaxed with it. Unfortunately, he puts such emphasis on the line, "and a kid someday," that it kind of stops the whole show, and for me it really ruins the take, unfortunately. Still, it's an interesting record in that this is really Bruce's first released solo performance of Disney Girls. The version that appears on the Goin' Public album is also very simple. It's mainly Bruce's piano and vocal with some backing vocals in the middle eight. Interestingly, he's gone from making wine in his garage on Surf's Up to making wine in his parents' garage on this version. I wonder why that is. Maybe he had to move back in with his parents after that Beach Boy money dried up. On the other hand, I think he must have been doing pretty well. Anyway, the tempo slows way down at the end, and the group harmony of the original is replaced by Bruce just going do-do-do-do-do-do-do, and an electric keyboard replaces the whistling on the Beach Boys' original version. It's a nice, simple version, almost like a demo. I much prefer the Beach Boys' version, but the song is undeniable, and it's certainly a highlight of the Goin' Public album. Next up is Rock and Roll Survivor, which is a country-flavored number, and as far as I can tell, is one of two songs on the album that hadn't been previously released by someone else. Thematically, the song is kind of similar to Barry Mann's 1975 single, I'm a Survivor, which Bruce had produced and provided backing vocals for. It's clearly a different song, but it sounds as if I'm a Survivor may have inspired it. The tune of Rock and Roll Survivor reminds me a bit of Dottie West's 1973 hit, I Was Raised on Country Sunshine, which had been used in a Coca-Cola ad on TV. Again, it's kind of a standard country tune, so I'm sure it sounds like a lot of other country songs as well. I just happened to think of that one. And can anybody tell me what Bruce is singing in the intro? There's a line that sounds like, I saved my money wisely and built a scooter made of wood. Now, I doubt that many musicians go into rock and roll with dreams of building themselves their own scooter, particularly one made out of wood. Like, hey, Jagger's out in the garage making himself a new scooter on the bandsaw. What's he really saying there? Moving on, we get the second of the two songs that I believe had not been released anywhere else. It's Bruce's Don't Be Scared. This is not the same song that the Ripcords released as a single A-side in March 1965. This is a Bruce original. It's another emotional Bruce ballad with an extremely beautiful melody. It's got the usual piano and vocal arrangement with a small string section that really works nicely. Bruce's vocal is beautiful, and there are a lot of changes that I'm sure were not easy to sing. This actually would have been a really nice one for the Beach Boys to have covered, and it's a shame they never did their own version of it. The final track on the album is the second cover, Pipeline, Bruce's disco version of a song that had been a number four hit for the Shantays back in May of 1963. Coincidentally, the Shantays' original version spent the weeks of May 4th and May 11th, 1963 in the number four spot, only to be replaced on May 18th at number four by the Beach Boys' Surfin' USA on its way to its number three peak. Bruce said that this version of Pipeline developed out of an in-studio jam. It's not surprising that they came up with a disco version of a surf record. At this point, they were discifying everything. There were disco classical records, disco exotica records, disco big band records, disco versions of television themes, and even disco big band with TV themes on the B-side. The disco craze was still a year or two away from its zenith, but all the disco tropes are already in place and on display here on Pipeline. Deirdre from the album, it certainly had some disco overtones, but this is so different, it really feels like it's part of a different project. It was the single from the album, was released on a 12-inch, the first for Columbia Records. The B-side, not surprisingly, is the next most danceable track from Bruce's album, Deirdre, which is identical to the album track. The single version of Pipeline runs 8 minutes and 30 seconds compared to the 4 minutes and 35 seconds on the album. The main noticeable difference on the single version is a section in the middle with rhythm, birds, and ocean waves that vary the sound of the track and I think also kind of hide the edit where they start the track over again to make the extended version. Surprisingly, the single version of Pipeline went to number 33 in the UK, which is not bad at all. The single also came with a hype sticker, which I'll show. Reading Bruce Johnston featuring Pipeline and Deirdre, special disco versions from the album Goin' Public. The album was promoted with a full-page ad in the June 14, 1977 issue of Rolling Stone. But apart from the Pipeline single's relative success in the UK, the album seems to have made little impact, and as we know, Bruce was back full-time with the Beach Boys 3 years later. Goin' Public is an enjoyable record, and is Bruce's only solo album after the early 60s, it's unique. There's certainly nothing here to set the world on fire, and while Bruce writes some great songs, he doesn't seem to be very prolific, so I kind of wonder how he would have followed up had this album been a smash hit. I have a particular fondness for solo albums. I like to hear members of my favorite bands on their own to see what they really bring to the mix. And Goin' Public certainly showcases Bruce's piano playing, his beautiful voice, and his great melodic sense in his songwriting. Not a landmark album of the 70s, maybe, but it is a great way for Beach Boy fans to spend some time focusing on the unique character of Bruce Johnston's work. I hope you enjoyed this. Please comment. Please let me know, particularly, has Rock and Roll Survivor or had Rock and Roll Survivor and Don't Be Scared ever appeared anywhere before they appeared on Goin' Public? Please let me know, too, if you have any other comments, what you think of the album. Always interested to get your take on it. Please like and subscribe if you haven't done that. I really appreciate you doing that. We'll see you next time. Thanks. Bye.